Welcome to part two of the Funny Indian Show podcast with Maz Jobrani, and I wanted to revisit something you mentioned just a couple of minutes ago in part one. You said comedians tend to become comedians, comics become comics, because they're good at several things, but not necessarily one particular thing. Could you expand on that? I think that's an interesting topic.
Yeah, I mean, I've talked about this a few times. First of all, stand-up comedy is the one skill that you really don't need any. I mean, the one I should say art form. You really don't need any talent to get into it.
Like, Steve Martin talked about that.
Yeah, right? You could be anything. I mean, mm-hmm. It's like all you need is just get on stage and you get a mic and start talking into it. Mm-hmm. Like if I wanted to be a guitar player or mm-hmm. a musician, at least mm-hmm. I have to learn a few chords.
Sure.
Piano, same thing. Mm-hmm. But that's why if you go to the open mic night at the Comedy Store on Sundays mm-hmm. and Mondays, you get everybody. Like there's pimps. I saw a pimp come one time. I'm not kidding. A pimp in a red suit. Went up on stage, started telling jokes because he thought he had it, you know.
Right.
So that's all it takes, really.
Boom Shakalaka's friend, probably.
Yeah, exactly. Now the difference is with stand-up comedy. I think there's a couple of things. First of all, I think that there is you do have to have like a knack for it, and then secondly, and more importantly, you do have to put in the time.
Sure.
You know. So and by time, I mean like several years. But that said, it's like we tend to be. You know, like if you're someone who does accents, you don't have to do them really well. You mm-hmm. can kind of do them kind of half-assed, and it works on stage. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't have to be like this. You don't need a dialect coach to become right. To do your accents on stage.
On stage,
you know, or even sometimes you have comedians who do work music into their mm-hmm. act, and they might not be the best musicians,
right.
But they're good enough to work it into the act. You know,
sure.
Or like I'll do stuff like. Again, sometimes at the Comedy Store, like after my set's done, there's the piano player, Jeff Scott, he'll play some
right.
tune, and I'll start singing with like an operatic voice. I'll be like, hee hee ha ha, and I'll be like, I actually do it pretty well. And jokingly, I'll be like, I got a pretty good voice, you know? And I'm like, right. I could do that for like, you know, 2 minutes.
A couple of bars, yeah.
Put me into an opera.
Right.
I ain't doing shit. You know? I can't last, you know? Or like, I'll bust a move dancing or something. Mm-hmm. I've done that before where I'll dance, somewhere like a party or something,
right.
and someone will be like, they'll be like, "Oh, you got some good moves." I'm like, "No, I can fake a few good moves."
Exactly.
You get a real dancer in here. You know what I'm saying? So that's what
true.
I'm saying. It's like I think that a lot of us are really good at being like mediocre at a lot of stuff. Like
sure.
pretty good at some things.
Right.
But we end up being best at stand up, and
sure.
that's you know because that's what we're putting the time into.
That's our thing. I know you mentioned you went to Cal, you went to Berkeley. Do you use your college degree in any way? What did you major in?
I majored in political science with a minor in Italian, and I do talk about a lot of political stuff on stage. Mm-hmm. I mean, so I'm also interested in politics.
Sure.
I mean, it's not that I necessarily. I mean, political science degree is hard to use for anything anyway.
Right.
I actually thought I was going to go to law school, so
okay.
I thought it would be good for that.
Sure.
But there's some things that I learned in my classes mm-hmm. that definitely I think apply.
Did you ever want to run for office?
No, I wouldn't want to run for office. No.
Did you at any point?
No, I thought maybe I could have been a diplomat at some point mm-hmm. because I tend to be very diplomatic and mm-hmm. I tend to be very.
I could very much sense that.
Yeah, very
absolutely.
You know, peaceful. Sure. Let's settle down.
Sure.
Maybe one day, mm-hmm. Some president will appoint me as a special envoy, and I will finally solve the Middle East. Problem.
That segues so nicely into what I have to ask you about, which is the Middle East and what's going on over there right now. I try to make these podcasts as timeless as possible, but that's a topic that is always relevant for whatever reason.
Yeah.
But particularly now with Egypt, Tunisia, Libya, everything, any perspective that you have, I know that's a very broad question. But,
no, I mean, it's been interesting for me, too. I've been watching it, and it's amazing how it's all happened. I mean, as someone who was born in Iran and left the country during the Iran Revolution.
You left in 79?
Yeah, we left late 78. Mm-hmm. And, my only question is I'd like to wait like 6 months to a year to see what comes out of it.
Right.
Because that's the problem a lot of times is that there's no set backup. Like,
right.
what are we doing next? Mm-hmm. And you hope for something very just organic comes out and it's a democratic system.
Right.
But, you know, right now, I was saying, as somebody pointed this out on the news, like right now in Egypt, the military is running it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not a very democratic
no.
organization.
They wanted to lift martial law and now it's, I mean, they're the military. That's not any real
yeah.
real difference.
Yeah, so I guess we'll see. Like, I hope for the best. Similar things can happen in Iran. I mean, ultimately you want people to be able to live in a free society where they can there's freedom of speech, freedom mm-hmm. of press, there's opportunity. You know, there's a lot of. I mean, when you travel, especially Egypt, these are so poor, And in a lot of these countries, you have a lot of the haves and a lot of the have-nots.
Right, right, right.
Libya right now looks crazy. Gaddafi's just nuts. That guy's like, he's straight up.
He was calling people, what, cockroaches and all this kind of stuff. And he would just scream, cuckoo, pounding that. He was like Khrushcheving it up there or something. Yeah,
yeah. He's just straight cuckoo. I mean, it's weird that somebody
Do you think guys like that are actually crazy? Or do you think that they're evil? Or do you think that they're...
I think that he's been living in such a bubble. Mm-hmm. And however, for whatever reason, he's had this stronghold. And, you know, we all assume that leaders of the world are sober. But he's probably smoking opium or something. You never know. I mean, I honestly believe, like, my dad, when he was alive, he would tell me that a lot of the mullahs in Iran, like, they get high on opium and stuff.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
So they're drugged up and they're making these
decisions.
They're
drugged up and making decisions and saying things. You know, they're not sober. And so they're like, that guy definitely does something. He doesn't look, I mean, you know, when you're like... When you're the president of a country for whatever 40 years,
yeah, he's
and
been here a long
you
time.
Basically he's probably a billionaire.
Yeah,
you know, people want his oil. He's, you know, think about, like, we think about guys like, you know, rock stars who do crazy rock starry things, like, you know,
smash up hotels, throw couches out windows,
and, worth, you know, several million. And they have chicks throwing stuff at them. These guys, it's almost like a god complex. You know, it's a cult of personality.
Yeah,
like Gaddafi could probably bang any chick he wants in Libya.
Right,
he just send some people out, be like, oh, bring that hot chick over. And probably a lot of them would be into it. Like
a lot of threesomes. It's Tripoli.
Well,
so.
Yeah, it's Tripoli. Yeah. Well, what's going on with Berlusconi right now? You know, it's
right.
Like, all these young, beautiful women are getting with him because he's a rich guy who's giving them money.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, these guys have this cult of personality. They're cuckoo, man. They're not. You're not sitting down with a guy who is
a centered. Like you said, sober,
logical. Hey, let's have a discussion. You want some herbal tea? Let's have some herbal tea. Let's discuss.
It's a different kind of herb that he's having.
Yeah,
different
herb for sure. He smoked the tea before.
That's crazy. No, but it's an exciting time, obviously.
Yeah.
This segues into maybe my favorite question. Are things getting better or worse?
You mean in the Middle East or the world?
Well, it's a question that is, all of these are open to interpretation, so I guess I just, you know, you can interpret
both.
It any way
I
you
would
like.
Say both. You know, I did a thing when I was in college. I went to the library, and I think I took out, was it in college or was it here? I forget where it was. But I took it, like, I was curious to just see what the news was reporting in 1979.
Sure.
So I took like a Time magazine, some New York Times, and started flipping through.
Sure.
And the problems are the same problems we have today. It's like back then, like in 79, it was like they were just getting Egypt and Israel to come together, but there was still like, you know, they'd just come off a war from a few years ago, Lebanon. It was always like the problems are the same.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of these problems haven't changed.
Mm-hmm.
They just keep cycling through.
Mm-hmm.
And you make a little bit of progress, and then it goes like with the whole thing with the healthcare. Like when Obama came in and said he wanted to do healthcare, I was like, this is great. Finally, Americans should all be, you know, insured. And first they watered it down. They freaked people out that, oh, you're going to have health insurance, and there's going to be death squads.
Death panels and all that stuff.
It was stupid. And then you're like, no, why are you guys believing this crap? And then it goes, and then they pass this watered down bill.
Right.
Where you go, oh man, we kind of made some progress, but we're not sure how much.
Right.
And now this Republican Congress is in, and they're going, oh, we want to repeal that. And you're like, but what was all those years, what was all that fighting for? You know, so it feels like,
three steps forward, two steps back,
always, that kind of thing. I think the best thing you can do is hopefully, you know, just do the best you can for yourself first, and then your family, and then your community, and then, you know, if you're lucky enough to be somebody like Mahatma Gandhi or Muhammad Ali or any of these guys who touch the world, you know what I'm saying? You can really start affecting Martin Luther King. You know, he changed the world.
Absolutely.
So maybe you get a chance to do that, and hopefully in a good way, you know?
I remember when I was several years ago, and I told my friend John, I said, I want to change the world. And he asked me a very simple question, and he stumped me. He goes, what needs to be changed? And I silence. And he goes, well, you keep saying you want to change the world. What needs to be changed? What does need to be changed? When Mahatma Gandhi says, be the change you wish to see in the world, I know we've talked about some things that piss you off or things, you know, things getting better or worse. What is that? What is the battle you feel like you fight? I mean, you obviously have a platform you can talk.
Well, there's a lot that can be changed. There's a lot that can be changed. I mean, it goes like, I mean, let's start with what I was talking about, the education system here in America. It's like, you can start with that. You can start by making it so that you know, my wife and I have a 2.5-year-old and we have a 1-month-old.
Mm-hmm.
And we're already having to go and look for private schools to put them into
right.
so that they can have a good education. Well, you know, it should be like, you know, a lot of other countries. I heard that, like, there was some Iranian students who'd come to study at universities, like good universities, like Princeton or somewhere in America. And, like, the first year course of engineering courses they were taking, they were saying that they already studied that stuff in their high schools. So even in Iran and in a lot of foreign countries, mm-hmm. the education system, they put so much more emphasis on education.
Sure.
In Europe, you go to the places and they put so much more mm-hmm. money and funny and emphasis into it that you see it affects the society.
Absolutely.
And so I would definitely, I mean, that's education is something I would love to get involved with. I always wanted to say, you know, one thing that was a great year for me was my junior year in Italy. And so I always said, I wish there were a program that would take all juniors in high schools and just send them overseas. And you have to go to all different types of places, whether it was like underprivileged countries in Africa mm-hmm. or wherever, or you know, some European country, mm-hmm. wherever, and it opens your eyes.
It just gives you such a sense of perspective.
Yeah, so if I had like a program that I could really get behind, I would definitely, that would be mm-hmm. one thing I'd definitely get behind, is mm-hmm. trying to send people overseas to go see and live with people of that culture in that country.
Sure.
And really learn to come back and appreciate America. I just read a thing yesterday, an article about how something like 30% of Americans have passports. Like, you know, we're so...
Is it that few?
Yeah, it's that few, yeah.
Wow.
We're so isolated and we're so closed-minded in that way. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, there's a lot that I think can be changed. I mean, there's that, there's, you know, again, less funding for military and maybe more funding for other things like mm-hmm. research, whether it's cancer research or other types of mm-hmm. research. There's a lot that can be changed. You know, you go to the Middle East, there's a lot that can be changed. There's, you know, you see a lot of young people in the Middle East that have no opportunities. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of restrictions on, mm-hmm. You know, freedom of speech.
Sure.
And all, you know, so I think there's a lot that you could do. You know, the weird thing is that a lot of the stuff seems to me obvious. And then mm-hmm. and then once you start implementing it, like, again, I'll use Obama's healthcare as an example. Once you start implementing, you realize, wow, there's opponents of this.
Mm-hmm.
And you go, how could you be opposed to giving health care to, you know, young people? And there's people out there that are opposed for whatever reason it is. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's not in the budget, or oh, it comes with a side thing that makes it so that we have to put money towards, I don't know, mm-hmm. you know, building freeways in Wisconsin,
sure.
you know, whatever, you know, the whole... It's a pork belly.
Pork, yeah, the pork.
The pork, yeah.
That's why if Obama's really Muslim, he'd vote against pork. That would be the good thing.
Yeah,
that would be the good
right,
thing.
Yeah.
I really love puns. You can really tell how punny I like to be.
Very punny.
When did it all change? Do you think things have changed, or do you think, like you said, it was cyclical? I mean, do you think things that... Do you notice any, like for example, if you were to say, when did it all change in Iran, 1979 would be a pretty good answer.
Yeah, of course.
Do you think things changed in this country at a certain point? There was an inflection point where...
Well, the things that have changed now is probably the technological stuff. Like, that seems to be the big change in America.
Right.
It doesn't seem like there's been a big social change mm-hmm. since the 60s when you mm-hmm. had, you know... The civil rights movement.
Mm-hmm.
But after that, it feels like, I mean, it almost feels like a lot of Americans are more and more comfortable, and it's harder to get Americans out to protest things.
Right.
Or, I mean, that's
very much so.
Yeah, or like stand up for anything. You mm-hmm. know, they don't get, Bush stole the election. Oh, well, move on.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to go to war with Iraq without any real reason.
Right.
Yeah, whatever. You know, we had a lot of people protesting, but it should have been even more.
Oh, yeah, and it didn't match the number of protests around the world where people were demonstrating everywhere. I was in India at the time, actually, and the protests there were on a large scale, larger than here.
Yeah, so I think what's changed now is just technology in mm-hmm. America, you know.
Right. Who has it figured out?
Who has it figured out? Babies. Babies have it figured out, man. These babies, they poo... then they eat, and then they sleep.
Right.
And then they poo again, and then they eat, and they sleep. That's it. It's a nice...
So senior citizens, too.
Senior citizens have to figure out, because then... Well, senior citizens, unfortunately, a lot of them, like, you know, start losing their mind.
Sure.
But in a way, it's kind of like, you got to go, like, is he pretending?
Yeah.
He just doesn't care. I was actually going to work on a bit. We were talking about this with Amir K about how, like, brother's going, like, once you hit 70, you stop caring.
Right, right, right.
You're like, I'm 70 years old. Fuck it. I'm doing whatever I want.
It's a good reason. It's like when it's too early in the mornings, and anyone asks you, God, man, it's 6:30 in the morning. You could give that as a response to anything. Yeah, it's like, because it's just too early, by definition. That's too late in life. That's funny. That's funny stuff. I'm a fan of Amir Kay. He's a good guy. What's the most important thing in life?
Well, health. Your health is definitely, like, a lot of times we take it for granted, myself included. You know, you eat the wrong things, you don't go to the gym, you know, you fall behind. Like we really should prioritize it. Like, you should really, you know, it should be, like, every day. Like, you should almost have a PE class every day, you know. Gotta go out and do this, because you take it for granted until, like, it's too late, until you find out, oh, my God, I'm obese and I need to get, you know, my heart operated or whatever. So that definitely, I mean, and then that sets you up to take care of everything else that's important, which includes your family and your friends, and that's kind of my answer to that.
I keep coming. You sounded like Forrest Gump. That's all I have to say about that. I know I keep coming back to this $1 million. I just noticed I have a lot of $1 million questions for whatever reason, but take it to mean a lot of money. Can a person make $1 million honestly? This is something that I think of all the time, where I see, you know, rich folks who've made a ton of money. Do you think they do it honestly, or is there always a behind every great fortune?
That's like,
great
yeah, they say, what was that? It was in the beginning of The Godfather in the book. I think he quotes, is it Cicero? Who says
it? Is it behind every great fortune is a great crime?
Yeah.
Is it that one?
It is, yeah, I mean, it depends on how much you're talking. If you're talking $1 million, I think you can make that honestly.
Sure.
I think once you start getting into, like,
say a billion.
You know, once you start getting, a lot. I mean, you know, you look at a lot of fortunes that were made. It's either there was a crime behind it, or there was some sort of cheating behind it, or there's just like total blind luck. You know what I'm saying? Like, other than that, it's hard. I mean, I'm sure there's been times in history where someone became a billionaire because they were smart. They figured out,
like Zuckerberg, maybe.
Zuckerberg. Well, now they're saying that he stole the idea from this guy.
Right? Yeah. In the movie.
So it's not. It's not necessarily a crime where he can be thrown in jail. There's enough. We have to pay $65 million to a couple guys to shut up and whatever.
In an undisclosed amount to Eduardo. Yeah, right.
So that's. I mean, I don't know. I think, like I said, I mean, you know, you could, like, for example, yeah, you know, you could make a, like, I could make Jimmy Westwood and suddenly becomes the biggest hit ever and it makes $100 million.
Yeah.
Well, hey, I lucked into that. You know, what I mean, I definitely put the right things together, but there's also great movies that don't get that.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's either some serious luck involved or some...
Or some hanky-panky.
Yeah.
Of some sort. okay, this is a little bit deeper. What really happens when you die? What do you think? And where did we come from? How did this all start? What are your thoughts on the...
Boy, I don't think about that much. I mean, once in a while, I mean, I'm not religious. I have, you know, I've lost my father and grandfather, and... And once in a while, you'll, like, you know, think to yourself, there's got to be, like, their spirit's got to be somewhere. Like, you almost talk to it or something, you know. Or you think, oh, my God, it's alive again through my son or my daughter. Like, I remember talking about with my grandfather. He was very close to us. Like, he lived with us, and he was a great man.
You throw him in the mix for his birthday, right? He got to be quite old, and he'd have several birthdays a year.
He was sharp to the end, man. And when he passed away, I was like, God, I feel like someone's taken this, like, piece of me. Like, I felt empty. And I was like, I don't know if I will ever be able to refill that. And I was talking to my wife about this recently. Like, I think kids help refill that. So, I don't know. I don't know what happens when you die. I mean, I think you remain a memory for others, and maybe you're a spirit. I'm not sure. I mean, I always said, like, having dealt with my grandfather and father's passing away, and, like, because you go to get the grave all put together, and it's like they start, you know, the cemetery, they start selling, it's like you're buying, like, a car. They're like, well, you can do the $5,000 one,
right,
it's kind of broken down piece of, you know, casket, or you could do the $10,000. Like, you spend so much money. So I always said, like, you know, just burn my ashes and put them out somewhere, you know.
That's what I say.
Yeah.
Well, that's what Hindus believe, at least, is it's ashes to ashes, dust to dust, so we sort of get scattered and whatever else. And plus, there's so many people in that country, I guess, if you started burying everybody, then you'd have no room left. Yeah. Absolutely. That's probably a lot of it, probably the reason for it. I just lost my grandfather. He just passed away. He was 98 years old.
Yeah, my grandfather's 98 too.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's an amazing, amazing life to live that long. And I've always thought about it. I'm like, I don't know if I'd... I've always thought I'd live to be 85 or 90. I don't know why. I just, I'm like, yeah, I'll live to be pretty old. But getting anywhere close to 100, I think, is it's an accomplishment.
It is pretty crazy.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
It seems like this generation, at least... young folks, Gen Y, whatever you want to call them, seem to be like quitting their jobs, looking for more. At least a lot of my friends have, where they've left fairly cush jobs, whether it was in a good time or a recession. What do you think is going on? Do you think something's going on in the zeitgeist? Do you think people are looking for more? Is it something
maybe
you haven't noticed?
Like maybe what's evolved from, like, you know, it used to be like in the 50s in America, it was like, you know, get a good job, get a wife, get the white picket fence, you know, and then you get like your 60s and it's and the war, and then everyone's going off to war, and then like in the 70s where it's rebellion against that, and then the 80s it's like cocaine and back to getting a good job and money.
Gaddafi.
90s. I guess it's, I think part of it is just, part of it I think is, again, like with the internet and all, there's more information available to people, and I think people have like a higher sense of, like have evolved a little bit more spiritually in their ability to go, why should I take some crappy job that's just killing me every day? And maybe I can live with less and do what I love. So it's good to see that. I think more people should do that. I think money does not equal happiness. So the more people find that out, and the more people are just able to do things that make them happy, then the, you know, that happy quotient goes up, and before you know it, No more wars.
Yeah, most wars are tied to money in some way.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, behind every great fortune, right? Great crime, we covered that. So, how would you define manhood? What does it mean to be a man in modern society?
Well, man has become very watered down as well in modern society. I mean, it used to be like man of the house, like, you know, woman, go to the kitchen, and but now, like, I mean, I honestly think that part of being a man is, like, caring for your kids, you know? I love, you know, feeding my, I mean, I don't love being up at 3 a.m. feeding the baby, but I do love holding her and feeding her and changing her. You know, it's like taking charge. I think that's one of the things that manhood defines, kind of manhood. Taking charge in any aspect. It goes back to that picking up the bill thing.
When
you can pick up the bill, it's almost like, hey, you're starting to arrive as a man, you know?
Right.
And the same thing goes with any situation, whether it's an urgent situation or it's like, you know, making dinner reservation or, you know, going to a restaurant and they say, oh, we're full. And you're like, hey, don't worry, we'll take care of this. You go, you know, slip the guy 20 or whatever.
Right.
Or you talk the guy into it, whatever it is.
Right.
That, I think a lot of that involves manhood. And I think, you know...
Well, there's that Curb Your Enthusiasm where Larry David does that. I know you've been on the show where he slips the guy at 20 or whatever, and Cheryl just says, I find you very attractive right now.
Getting it done. Yeah.
Absolutely
right.
Yeah. That's wild. Because I know our mutual friend, and I've worked with him a lot, and I know you've worked with him a ton, Sebastian. He seems to cover a lot of, you know, sort of man topics and where did men really go and all that sort of stuff. I think it's helpful to define it. Why don't the homeless move to Florida? You're a political scientist. You're a comedian. I've never understood, especially the number of times I've been in New York and Chicago, and I see folks, and obviously I say it frivolously, and it's, of course, very sad, and I'm saying it in jest to make a point, but I do see folks, you know, it's 20 below, and they're homeless. Why don't they walk to
Florida? Well, you know, it's funny you bring that up, because I was just watching something on Reagan. They were doing a documentary on Reagan, and it's interesting. They're talking about that a lot of his policies kind of led to more and more homeless. It wasn't as many homeless people, but like a lot of the policies it did, like breaking unions and a lot of jobs that were lost, led to a lot of that. And some of the homeless is people that are not completely...